Holy Gospel according to Matthew, the 18th chapter.
Glory to you, Lord.
If another member of the church sins against you, go and point out the fault when the two of you are alone. If the member listens to you, you have regained that one. But if you are not listened to, take one or two others along with you, so that every word may be confirmed by the evidence of the two or three witnesses. If the member refuses to listen to them, tell it to the church. And if the offender refuses to listen even to the church, let such a one be to you as a Gentile or a tax collector. Truly I tell you, whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven. Again, truly I tell you, if two of you agree on earth about anything you ask, it will be done for you by my Father in heaven. For where two or three are gathered in my name, I am there among them. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise be to you, O Christ.
You may be seated. Grace to you and peace, God our Father, and our Lord and Savior, Jesus the Christ. In seminary, one of the situations we pastors are taught to avoid is something called triangulation. That's where one member of a congregation comes to the pastor with a complaint they have about another member of the congregation. Rather than working it out themselves, people often try to involve a third person, not as a mediator to help the two work out their differences, but instead of having to deal with one another. The involvement of this third person is why it's referred to as triangulation. And while it's a relatively new term, it's obviously been happening amongst human beings for a very long time. Our gospel text this morning seems to be aware of this tendency, because the first step Jesus gives to resolving a conflict or problem between two people is for those two people to discuss it one to one. Why bring in a third party if it's not necessary? Not only is telling someone else about your complaint not likely to help resolve it, but you may needlessly embarrass or shame the other person if you don't give them the opportunity to rectify the problem themselves. In Jesus' time, this concern was especially important, as honor and shame were significant elements of that culture. To air your dirty laundry, as we might put it today, would bring shame on the other person, and perhaps even on yourself. Even though we don't have the same honor-shame society, it still makes sense to talk with someone directly about agreements you have with them. First, they may not be aware of the problem, that what they've done has harmed you in some way. Telling that person about it can often stop the behavior. If it doesn't, then you can bring in someone else. In our gospel, it suggests bringing one or two others along. In that culture, it required two witnesses to validate someone's claim. So that may be why that is the next step described in our gospel. For us, bringing in another person can also make sense. Perhaps the third person can help the two better understand one another, or can see something that neither of the other two can see in the way of resolution. If that still doesn't work, then the complaint comes before the church, the whole church community. But this process is not limited to churches. Even in our day-to-day lives, the principles of talking directly with someone you have a complaint against is good advice, as is the second step of enlisting a third person as observer or mediator if the first step doesn't work. But back to the church. If one cannot resolve the problem individually or with a couple of other people, it comes to the whole congregation. And if that still doesn't work, the person who has done something wrong is to be considered like a Gentile or a tax collector. Now, in the Jewish society of Jesus' time, those were considered very despicable people. Tax collectors were collaborators, carrying out the work of the Roman Empire by collecting taxes and lining their own pockets by overcharging people. Gentiles was another term for pagans or Greeks, who were worshippers of false gods. So it would seem that a member of a church that won't change their wrongful ways was to be considered as bad as thieves. Or were they? Keep in mind how Jesus treated tax collectors and Gentiles. He ate with them, healed them and their children, and even fed them. As he would tell his detractors, "Those who are well have no need of a physician, but those who are sick. I have come to call not the righteous, but the sinners." If that's the case, does that mean that there are no consequences for those who refuse to change their wrongful ways? I suppose it would depend on the situation. If someone were stealing wine from the sacristy, then perhaps that person should no longer be allowed to be part of the altar guild, but might still continue to be part of the church community. How else will people change their ways if they are refused contact with a nurturing and loving Christian community? Doing something wrong shouldn't necessarily mean expulsion from the community of believers, though there may be consequences for their behavior. A young man in the congregation down in Oakland, where I did my teaching parish, was convicted of grade tampering at a local college. Although along with some others, he was sent to prison for several years. Although he had to face the civil consequences of his action, he was not forgotten by the congregation. They had a laying on of hands the Sunday before he was to start his sentence and kept him in their prayers throughout his incarceration. Here in Montana, one of the newer congregations in our synod is at the Montana State Penitentiary. The synod called a pastor to serve that congregation, and they are using volunteers to help with regular Bible studies and worship services. These folks at the prison have a great need to hear the good news and to be part of a Christian community. The result has been many baptisms, as well as a lower recidivism rate. That is, among those who worship together at the prison, there is less likelihood of committing another crime after release. What's interesting throughout the whole process that's described in our gospel lesson is that the term forgiveness is never used. Rather, the goal seems to be restoration of a relationship. If the member listens to you, that is, if the member who has wronged you listens, you have regained that one. Relationship has been restored between these people and within the Christian community. Unfortunately, too often in our society, what we want when we've been wronged is vengeance, punishment, and the restoration of the time and money that we've lost. We nurture our hurts rather than working to heal the broken relationships that caused them. We talk to other people about what's been done to us, perhaps to earn sympathy for how we've been wronged, rather than dealing directly with the person who hurt us, so we might regain that relationship. And this not only happens in our society, it happens in our churches. People often leave churches where they've been hurt, or where things haven't gone as they would have liked, rather than staying to work on the broken relationships. But Jesus has a different process in mind. Seek to restore the brokenhearted and the broken relationships. Love one another as I have loved you. It's not always easy. In fact, it is rarely easy. But it is what we are called to do. May God grant each of us the strength and the grace to do so. Amen. I invite you to stand as you are able for our hymn of the day, number 604.